everyone. We're almost at Christmas, so which means at a certain point I'm going to have to shut up for the holidays. But today I want to talk about another myth, and it's down there, written up there. There's no way to know what your birth will be like, therefore there's nothing you can do to prepare for it. Now, why am I bothering to talk about the myths of childbirth that women have told each other, sometimes for generations, and sometimes just since I gave birth first in the 1970s? It's because we're giving each other inaccurate information often, and that inaccurate information leads to our thinking and our actions, which could be different if we were given appropriate and correct information. So today we want to talk about the difference between truth and inaccurate information. So it is absolutely true that I have to move something, excuse me. It's absolutely true that there is no way to know what your birth is going to be like. Every woman around the world throughout time knows that. Even if this is our 10th baby, we know that each birth will be different. That's true, absolutely true. However, it's followed by an inaccurate statement, which is therefore there's nothing you can do to prepare for it. Now, I've spent a lot of time in third world countries, not involved in birth other than talking about it. I've also read a lot when I was going through university and doing my medical anthropology degree around traditional childbirth globally. And there are a few very good books that talk about what we did traditionally within our diverse traditional cultures to try to make pregnancy and birth in the newborn period safe for mothers and babies. Those things focused on diet, what you eat and don't eat, whether you sit in a doorway or not, that can constrict a baby, whether you look at a pig and therefore the baby's going to come out looking like a pig, or whether we have sex or not, whether we live in our own home or go back to our own home if we're living in our husband's home or somewhere else. There are do's and don'ts in every culture around pregnancy and childbirth, without a doubt. And there are many cultures that do a lot of massage, and there are some cultures, fewer, that actually have women prepare the birth canal. And all cultures do this because we want pregnancy and childbirth to be safe for the mother and baby. However, we have never had a universal way to prepare our pregnant body to birth our baby, or a universal set of skills that we can use no matter how our baby's birth unfolds, until birthing better. And this is why I've dedicated 45 years of my life to these skills, because they are universal, and that's a new concept, and they are based on our human body, which we all share. We are all one humanity, no matter what language we speak, no matter the culture, the religion, and any woman could get pregnant by any man, and any child can be brought up in any culture. And in my generation is the first time we've had a global ability through the internet to have conversations globally. And also the modern world is taking precedence. There are fewer and fewer really traditional cultures as people modernize more and more. And so therefore we're thinking more in terms of what is universal and what is common to all of us. So I want to explain why the truth, there's nothing you can do to prepare your pregnant body, and why it's important to understand. Sorry, there's a comment here. Wow. So we can get comments. Anyway, Elaine, hi, how are you? This doesn't mean I'm going to know how to answer them while I'm trying to talk. So there is no way to know what your birth is going to be like, but we want to talk to you about the universal way that you can prepare your body for childbirth and the universal skills that you can use to birth your baby, no matter where you birth, no matter who is with you, and no matter the type of birth that you have. And one of the other myths I'm going to talk about is about natural birth, because in my lifetime, this division between natural and medical birth has just blossomed. It's risen up. But you're only interested really in your baby's birth, in your birth, your experience. And every woman wants a positive birth experience. We can't get the birth we imagine. Very few women actually get a birth that they plan. We get the birth that unfolds, which means that we are either left feeling totally impotent, or we can become empowered because we choose to do the activity of giving birth with a really good set of skills. So the first thing we need to understand to debunk this myth is that when you are pregnant, you just join this pregnant group. Your baby doesn't grow in your ear. It doesn't grow in your big toe. It grows inside your belly like every other pregnant woman's experience. You don't conceive and give birth in 24 hours. We'd all be in shock, right? It's somewhere around 7 months to 9.5 months or 10 months if you aren't going by the modern calendar. Babies that are born really before 27 weeks didn't stand much of a chance to survive before the modern world. And yes, of course there were stillborn babies, and of course there were problems around birth, but that didn't mean that it happened to everybody, but it meant that it happened, but that was still our baby's birth. So when you were pregnant, there is only one natural conclusion to pregnancy, and that is that you give birth one way or another. The women in the tsunami in Indonesia were still giving birth. In war in Syria and Iraq, they're still giving birth. If there's a drought and a famine, women are still giving birth. Once you're pregnant, you give birth. So can you do something as a collective group of women in their consciousness, prepare for the birth of their baby? Well, in the modern world now, 30% or more of women have a non-laboring surgical birth. That is still the birth of your baby. Your body is still developing the hormones and preparing to labor and have a vaginal birth, which means that your mind, your emotions, everything is preparing for you to have a baby and to give birth, which means that you can prepare your body for this birth. And you do it because you're not going to be pregnant very often. You get to do it to become closer to your baby, to enjoy this pregnancy, to tell your baby you are preparing for its birth, to get closer to your partner or the person who's going to support you. Your mind knows you're going to have a non-laboring cesarean, but the pleasure, the delight, the involvement, the joy of being pregnant and birthing a baby is at your fingertips with skills. That's what birthing better is about. It's important to understand that just because your mind knows you're going to have a surgical birth doesn't mean your body knows that. And so you get to revel in this beauty of your pregnancy and the joy of your pregnancy. Because up until recently, women accepted a lot of whatever happened at birth because it was about becoming a mother, having a baby. So the emphasis wasn't on the birth experience. It was on birth as a transition to the experience of being a mother or a parent or having a baby. It's only been since the 80s that the emphasis has been on birth as a highlight experience. It's like the wedding being the highlight experience. And anybody who's married knows that the weddings, that's great. Spend a lot of time and energy on the wedding. You may have the wedding of your dream, but it's the marriage. That's what you're focused on. So until recently, women accepted a lot of, they accepted birth because it was about the baby and afterwards. So you can prepare your body for the birth. And with birthing better, what we learned was that we're growing a big object. So we have to then learn to open our body to let this baby out. And we have the skills to do that. The hip lift that creates space side to side, the sacral maneuver that creates space front to back. But you do those things because you first mapped your pelvis. Do you have a narrow pubic arch? Do you have a broad pubic arch? What's the distance between the bones you sit on? What's the length between the pubic arch and your tailbone? Is your sacrum curved or flat, narrow, long, or short? Is your tailbone long or short? Does it curve under? That's the physical space your baby needs to navigate through. So when you prepare that physical space to give birth, you are saying to your baby, I am going to help you come out of me. And you do that from 24 weeks onward in pregnancy. Because at 24 weeks, your uterus is up at your navel. And this is when you begin to realize, geez, I've gone through more than half of my pregnancy and the birth is around the corner. So this is the time when your mind is clear enough so that you can little by little acclimate your body to learning how to open up. And this is why we have to debunk the myths like the pelvic floor exercises and the Kegels. Stop doing them at 24 weeks. Pick them up after the birth. Tighten up now. Is a big object going to come out of you if you are strong inside? No, it's not. Okay, you want to be strong inside for my age, not when you're pregnant. So stop doing the pelvic floor exercises. Learn to open up and expand. Be flexible and mobile and create space. And then it's all about being able to work through the birth journey you and your baby take together. And this is where it doesn't matter if you are using skills while you drive to the hospital, while being prepped or in surgery. Your drive to the hospital is your labor. Your being prepped is your transition. The surgery is your baby's birth. You don't want to be a passive person, someone disengaged, someone disconnected from the birth of your baby. By learning good breathing and relaxation, communication and touch skills, you make the decision that you are going to use skills to birth your baby throughout the journey you and your baby make. If you go into labor, labor can be very vague. You can have niggling labor for days. And we'll talk about a myth about how to handle niggling labors. The fact is as your body is making this transition period, whether you're going to have a non-laboring cesarean or go into labor, your body is having Braxton Hicks contractions. And that's a contraction. So use your skills to that and then allow that to just evolve into the contractions. When you've used your breathing skills, your communication, touch, relaxation skills very early on, then it becomes a habit. You just do those things through this journey you take with your baby. Your baby's journey is an activity. We can look at it as it's an event, something that happens to which we are a participant, but we don't know exactly what our role is. So we're there happening. We're trying to plan it through what we want and don't want. But if what we want doesn't unfold and if what we don't want does happen, then if it's only an event, we become passive and disengaged and we end up with a shame, blame, guilt, disappointment, anger that has just blossomed. If it's something that happens to us, that's the sentence. There's really nothing you can do to prepare for it because there's no way to know what your birth's going to be like. So if we're just cast into a river or the winds of change blow us around, then we will just feel that this experience happens to us and we have absolutely no control. And the one thing that all pregnant birthing women want is control. And the way you get control is not to plan for the birth. It's not to just accept what happens. It's to become skilled. Because ultimately, giving birth, what a weak word, giving birth, is that we have to do the activity of birthing our baby with our baby. It's a journey we take, a transformative journey. We are becoming a mother, and then we go through this transformative gateway called the birth. And after that, we are a mother. So we need to understand that there is no way to know what your birth's going to be like. It will unfold very unexpectedly for most of us. I didn't plan on having an 8-week premature baby. Come on. You know, most of you, whatever you planned, most of it didn't unfold the way you wanted it. It's always unexpected. So we can either throw up our hands, which is what we have done, or we can learn skills and use our skills. As one birthing better woman articulated it so beautifully, she said, "I have a choice in birth. I have a choice at every moment in birth," she said. "I have a choice of how I breathe in and how I breathe out." And that's true, because as humans, we can breathe in like this and expand inside and breathe out like this and soften inside. Or we can sound like this. Oh, 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 or ah, ah. And many of us do, because we do not have the fundamental understanding of how we breathe as human beings and how we can open with every breath and how we can soften inside with every exhale. Most of us do not have an understanding of whether we are open down there or tight down there. Most of us do not have an understanding of what positions keep us open and whether we tighten up inadvertently, either by structural tension, bending the space, or compressing it. And what I'm going to do now over the next few months is going to talk to you about debunking all of these myths so that your generation, it's no longer my children, they have children, right? So it's the next generation of women and men that can understand there is no way to know what your birth's going to be like, but you sure can prepare for the birth of your baby brilliantly and add the confidence that you have about birthing your baby, and then learn the birth and the birth coaching skills and work through your baby's birth journey, this activity that you are going to do, with a very high level of conscious skills, and come away from that birth, no matter where you birth, no matter who is present, and no matter what happens at that birth, no matter what happens, because you have used skills and you feel proud of staying in control and staying on top of it and being a great skilled manager of that birth experience with your baby. That's the lasting birth memories we want to leave you with. So I'm going to get off now, because I have a tendency to yak. So much in my mind and in my heart that I want to share with you. So see you later. Bye-bye.